I think we have to start, because I have about 400 slides for you. If you like 400 minimum, if you like to move now, take the opportunity. My name is Andreas Zick. You anyway see it on the program. I'm very honored to be here the second time. Second time. Last time the room was much smaller, but I had a lot of place to move around. But when I move now, I'm out of this picture. Oh no, he's following me. Okay. So this talk is videotaped for my friends from the right-wing extremist, the Islamist milieu, etc. pp. They follow me very much, very often. But I'm happy that I have a microphone, because it's a bit louder for you, right? Okay, I was invited to give a talk about group-focused enmity. Group-focused enmity, I will explain it in a minute. It's on prejudice, etc. But Monica did an excellent job. She already explained you so many things, so I can reduce my slides from 400 to 500. During the last year, the organizers of the summer school, they were so polite with me. They said, okay, maybe you talk once more about prejudices in Europe, etc. But during the last year, a lot of things happened across Europe. From my perspective, as a conflict and violence researcher, I'm managing an institute of interdisciplinary research on conflict and violence, so it's interdisciplinary. I'm a trained psychologist, my job is in education scientist, my faculty in sociology says, no, you are a member of our faculty, and the psychologists say, no, you are a psychologist. So it's interdisciplinary. But during the last months across Europe, something happened. The atmosphere, the climate in Europe, and especially in Germany, became radical. We are doing so many research since so many years, but I personally have never been offended so often and so aggressive like in the last months. Last Sunday, we had a meeting of a new party, Alternative für Deutschland, Alternative for Germany. Yeah, it's not an alternative, it's a way back to old Germany, but anyway. And they completely shifted the party to a right-wing extremist position. So I decided to change a bit my talk and speak about group-focused enmity and radicalization. So I will speak much more about processes of radicalization. And this fits to Monica's talk, because Monica talked about the roots, the psychological roots of why people can become radical. So it's an add-on what I can give you. I will present you a lot of numbers from our studies. What we are doing in Bielefeld is, since 12 years, we are running an annual survey on political opinions of the German population, since 12 years. We have a cross-sectional survey every year. We have a panel survey where we, since 12 years, are monitoring the attitudes of exactly the same persons. And in 2008, I conducted a big cross-European survey on prejudices. And I will show you some of these data from these surveys, but I don't go too much into detail, into statistical details. What I want to do is I want to bring up a story on radicalization, and then we can talk about it. And then you can say, no, I don't agree, I completely disagree, I have another perspective. But if it's opening a debate on radicalization, then it's fine for me. And I saw in your agenda, you have so many brilliant experts, they are much better than me. Markus is sitting right here in the room, he knows much more about anti-Gypsyism than I know. A lot of people, today you have another talk, so it's all an add-on. I just want to tell a bit about the phenomenon. But first, I want you to take a piece of paper, have a piece of paper, and let's do I have some questions for you. My first question is, what is this picture showing? You can simply note a keyword. What is this picture showing? Just make your own notes. I don't know. An airplane. Just note airplane. A bit louder, I don't. Sorry. Two houses. One house, two house, and a border between. Yeah. A concentration camp. Railway crossing. And what is this? What is this here? That's a pool. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So just note. I will explain it a bit later. Neighborhood. Yeah. Some neighborhood. Yeah. And who painted? Who painted this picture? Bitte? A kid. How old?
About five.
Who has children at home? No one? You're too young. A refugee? Refugee? Kid, 5 years, a refugee. That's a huge difference, right? Okay, it's just you cannot know it. You cannot know it. So it's just we are... Okay? Just simply... I will come back to it later. Now, second. My second, what is Übung? I forget the term, Übung. Exercise, oh my God. I've not been in schools for so many years. I'm waiting for the retirement. Exercise. Exercise number two. Now note, do you agree? And then you make a plus. Or do you disagree? And then you make a minus on your sheet of paper. Do you agree to the sentence, to this attitude, I approach everyone without prejudices? If you agree, make a plus. If you don't agree, minus. Okay? I accept everyone the way she or he is. Plus, minus. I am tolerant. Plus, minus. I am open towards strangers. Plus, minus. Okay? You have it? Now we change. No. Let's keep on. Exercise number three. So this is not a lecture, it's a workshop where you have to work. Do you agree or disagree with this sentence? I will be happy about a stronger welcome culture for migrants in my country. We have people from so many countries, so in your country, are you happy about a stronger welcome culture? Okay? Plus or minus? I am happy that so many migrants, it's not migrants, decide for my country to be their home. It's not migration, I don't know where the mistakes come from. Yeah? I'm happy that so many migrants decide for my country to be their home. Okay? I like it when migrants who come to my country keep their cultural roots. Do you agree or disagree? The people of my country have to adapt better to the migrants. Okay? Who is new somewhere or came later has to be pleased with less at the beginning. Okay? It is important that we put our identities, values, and character more into the center. I have to say I'm very sorry for my bad English. I did not check it by a native speaker. Yeah, but compared to you, I'm an old man, so this might explain my bad English. Okay. Now exercise number four. What do you see? I hope that the sound is enough. What do you see? Just tell me, what do you see? Who is that? Okay, just an exercise. What did you see? Just, do you have an idea? What did you see? A neo-Nazi march. Why neo-Nazi march? Markus, do you know what we saw? Do you know it? Yeah. Okay. Any other? A demonstration? Yeah, something like this. Any other idea? In Germany, it's a forbidden video, what I showed you, but I'm allowed to show it. Okay. A march against somebody. How many people did you see? A lot. How many? 300. More than 1,000. More than 1,000. Markus, can you explain what we saw?
We saw a small neo-Nazi march.
Yeah.
I think about 120 or so.
Yeah.
They entered a small German city at night, made that procession, made that very professional video and disappeared.
Yeah, and disappeared. It was the Spreelicht that was forbidden, but now they come back.
Who took the video? Who was ready to take the video?
Yeah, the video was produced by them.
Ah, produced.
100 people, they doubled the people, they manipulated the picture, etc. It was on YouTube and was very successful. They had over 1 million clicks by young people who said, hey, this is great. Cool thing. Yeah, it's still there. Yeah, and they now, and after 2 years, they now announce that they will come back. They will come back. They are reorganizing. This was a very attractive video for young people. Very attractive. Over 1 million clicks. A lot of young kids said, "Hey, this is a cool thing," and the way they produced it. And why? You're younger than me. The music, the mask were very...
It's a very powerful narrative.
It's a very powerful narrative.
Globalization movement. Exactly. Very well produced. The music is, it's cool. I mean, the ideas are terrible, but the production is excellent.
Yeah.
I would say the most important thing is the narrative you are against.
And you are in the street. You are taking the street. You are taking the street, and you don't argue about all these groups, Jewish groups, Muslims.
Die Straße rein.
Unsterblich. We will never die. Remember what you have been. Be ever living.
Maybe they can connect with themselves with those videos of before World War II.
Yeah.
So thousands of millions of people are.
There's a tradition of these marches in the streets, these black costumes, like there's a lot in right-wing extremism, like remembering the Waffen-SS, etc. And it's black. You don't see our faces, we are one crowd, we are entering the street. And in the video, it's a very good production, it's a very good video production, it's a cool production. Now what we have in Germany, and you might heard of it, is a lot of polarization, and not a lot of polarization in our surveys and studies, but polarizations on the street. This is from the Pegida March, new right-wing populist movement. Yeah. This is angry Budapest. This is Budapest. This is from the Pegida March. A lot of polarization in the streets in the last months. And we are in Hungary, and you know it from Hungary, from Budapest. Yeah, a lot of rallies, a lot of demonstrations. Last year we published a book in June 2014. And the book was called The Fragile Center of Society. It was before these Pegida rallies, and you saw, might have heard in Germany. And we argued in this book that the state of European societies, especially we have to focus on Germany, is to some extent very fragile. Is fragile is correct? Yeah. It's very fragile. Why? Because in the center of the societies, there's something fragile. And what you saw are moments of fragility. To our opinion, a society is fragile if it accepts a certain level of ideologies of unequal worth between groups. Not inequality, but unequal worth between groups. And if it accepts misanthropic, and we call them menschenfeindlich, hostility against humans, human beings, cognitions, affects, and behavioral intentions, which object the norm, which guarantees the integration of everyone. And it's especially fragile if violence is a mean to regulate conflicts and is legitimated. And this is something very critical for European societies. The way you object the equal worth of another group, makes it fragile, because then societies may not guarantee your own integration. We all can have an accident today. It's possible. We all hope that it doesn't come, but it can be. And in this moment, when you have an accident, you might be a member of the group of handicapped people, disabled people, and then you're a member of a stereotype group. And Monica, the stereotype content model shows you that every one of us, even in this room, can be a member of one of these different groups, which is stereotyped. So what I want to talk to you and tell you, and then these exercises come back, and then you can compare your estimation with the average Germans. So you can, today you have the possibility to compare who's German here in this who's from Germany? Markus, and it is, Karina. So we let the other countries compare with us. I want to talk with you about this fragility, this enmity in a radical society. First, I want to walk with you a radical trail. I want to walk outside into the streets. Then I speak about curtain mentalities, about absorbing radical, about radicalization processes, and why sometimes people like these extremist radical groups. And then maybe I have time to speak about education. We all believe in the assumption that educate, 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 and then you can reduce prejudices. You believe it, I have data that it doesn't work. And maybe I have time to speak about outcomes. So let's walk a radical trail. This is what we saw starting last December in Germany. It started with a Facebook website, Pegida, Patriotic Germans Against the Islamization of Patriotic Europeans for the Islamizations of the West, yeah, of Germany. What did the people say? What did the people show in the street? They showed, it's enough. We are powerless. You are betrayed by all these politicians, by the European government. We are cheated. They say they are threats, the Islamization of society. It's hidden. It's constant. You have to stop it. Wake up. They don't belong to us, and this is one of the critical dimensions. Monica talked already about it. No Sharia in Europe. We are angry, and we are many, and we are the people, not you. These intellectuals sitting in the universities talking about stereotype content models. It's not time to speak about all these things. And we are many. Be aware. And we are anti-Europe, but in a European way. Look at UKIP. Look at Front National. Look to Finland, Sweden. It's a movement all over Europe. Italy. Greece. Oh, it's the same. Like I thought we only have right-wing extremism in Germany. Oh, no. It's a big European movement. Collect all these people together and you have millions. Millions marching on the streets. This is Hungary. Stop the influence and the manipulation of the elites. This is your hope in Europe, Angela Merkel. Look at the image. Anti-establishment against these intellectuals. We have the truth. We are the really tolerant people. Here in this room, I will come back to it. You noted your pluses. Open the borders for immigrants. Is this tolerance? We are tolerant. When we say stop, regulate immigration, then this is true tolerance, because we only take people who can adopt to our culture. And what you are talking about here in the summer school is political correct. We have to shift it. We can be politically incorrect. We are no Nazis. We are citizens of Germany. I like pork meat on my barbecue. Am I a Nazi now? This is what it says. And we have the truth. I don't know how often you read politically incorrect the website. This is a new house for asylum seekers in East Germany. And it's what, that's what the asylum seekers are doing. These are gifts for the kids. They throw it away. And this is the truth, which is not shown in the press. This information comes from the website Political Incorrect. We have the truth. We are telling the truth. Oh, yesterday evening I saw a lot of debates about Greece. And even in the mainstream media, they talked about the truth. We have a mission. And this mission is national Christianity. This is this cross in December was always in front of the demonstration, always in front of the demonstration. And look at the cross. It's in the national German colors. Black, red, and gold. And then one of the guys, it was December, bought, what is a Lichterkette? What is it around it? A chain of lights, because it's quite cheap now. Yeah? And this is the idea. It's not Christianity, it's not. And the German churches needed about 3 months to react on that. I couldn't understand it because I've never seen a cross in red, gold, in the national colors. Anyway. And we are young. And this is a photo of the last big rally. We are young and we are ready to fight. And this is what we saw on the streets. A lot of young people, especially young male people, a lot of hooligans were integrated into these demonstrations, yeah, because they simply received the task to control, to close the borders between the demonstrators, the right-wing populist demonstrators, and others. So there was a coalition between the young male fighters who said, yeah, we are against the Sharia, but let's fight. Let's fight for it. Stop talking about it. And you have adventure. This is an internet. This is an image of internet chats about 35,000 internet chats were analyzed on people who said, I like this new movement, this new right-wing populist movement, and this is an image of the websites they most like. So this is a star in German TV, this is a star in German TV, this is the Bild-Zeitung, the newspaper, the Boulevard Press. But they all also like McDonald's, they like Amazon, yeah? They like the Nationalist German Party, and they like Russia TV. This is the image. It's an image of the internet, the addresses they mostly like. So it's not a strict political thing. Yeah, it's entertainment. It's a political world of entertainment. That's what you're seeing. You see no political in the video. You don't see a political something anti-Semitic or so. Just simply, let's survive. So this was my radical walk in the streets. This is in the streets. Yeah, and this is something. Now it's discussed whether it disappeared or not. What happened in Germany in the last months, but it, as well in other European countries, was a significant. From a statistical point of view, a significant increase in hate crimes. Now, why is it possible? There's one assumption we always had during the last years, since 20 years. When you're doing research on prejudice, the assumption is very clear that you can argue that all this extremism, all this populism, it's not right-wing extremism what you saw, it's right-wing populism. A lot of ordinary people, they say, no, I don't fight, I'm not a right-wing extremist, but they take part. This is possible because in the center of society, there's a certain reservoir of negative attitudes toward minorities. And that's what I call the curtain mentalities. There are maybe 20,000 people on the street, but there are a lot of people behind the curtain and saying, yes, what they are doing, well, it's a bit aggressive, but I agree with it. I agree with it. So the bystanders, what in psychology they call the bystanders. Now let's talk about the bystander mentalities. We analyzed this new right-wing populist movement, and you can compare it all over Europe, and we said, okay, it's not a certain kind of syndrome ideology. But when you look into the mentalities of the people, There is group-focused enmity. There are prejudices against a lot of different groups. I will tell in a minute about it. But there's also anti-European ideologies. It goes against the US. There's some kind of nationalism. There's this ideology that democracy failed. You're cheated. So it's a bit cheating democracy indeed. And there's law and order, authoritarianism. Monica in the morning already talked about this in some sentences. And there's emotion, anger. There's hate. There's violence. Now let's see and let's have a look on German sentiments in these different fields. Group-focused enmity. I was expected to give a longer talk about group-focused enmity. What we are arguing in Bielefeld and what we are doing since now 14 years is research on what we call the syndrome of group-focused enmity. We argue that as soon as you measure qualitatively, quantitatively, a certain prejudice, you will see from the data that this is linked to other prejudices as well. Anti-Semitism and anti-Gypsyism, anti-Ziganism are linked. I will not speak about it because tomorrow. So this is not something we saw first. Since the 30s in the US, you have measuring of prejudices, and since you have data, you see correlations. So these prejudices are linked. Even anti-Semitism is special, historically, qualitatively different, but it's linked to other prejudices as well. And you know that if you walk down on the street, or if you go into the football arena, when you have anti-Semitic rallies, you see they are also sexist, etc., etc. The interesting point is that normally these different prejudices are discussed very separately. When I started in the 80s to do research on prejudice, I was invited in a conference on sexism, then I was invited to a conference on anti-Semitism, then I was invited on a conferences of anti-immigrant attitudes, and there were no links between the conferences. Makes no sense. The interesting point is they are not only linked. The question is, what is the core of all it? You can argue that the core is the suppression of people. The core is education. You can say authoritarianism is the core, which is linking all these prejudices. We argue that the core is an ideology of unequal worth. As soon as people accept the idea that there's inequality within society and there are groups above and groups below, there are groups who are much more important, who gain a higher value than others, an ideology of unequal worth of groups, as soon as people adopt this ideology, you are prone to develop the syndrome of group-focused enmity. As soon as you believe, yeah, these unemployed people, maybe these unemployed people can do a bit more. It's their own fault. As soon and you say, yeah, unemployed people are on the lower level of society because they don't work. And that's okay. And we have to differentiate between the groups. There are one groups on the top and the others are a bit more below. There are one groups more benefit to society, so they gain more and others gain less. As soon as you develop this idea, then you develop this syndrome. The syndrome tells us much more. It also says, if you have a reason, a cause for anti-Semitism, for example, I don't know where it is, here. If you have a certain cause of anti-Semitism, for example, relative deprivation, you have the idea that Jewish people, they are rich and wealthy, and you feel deprived. That this can cause anti-Semitism, but only to the extent that an ideology of unequal worth is triggered, and then this cause can also cause other prejudices, a lot of other prejudices. So for us, it's quite good to speak about anti-Semitism and other facets of prejudice. Also, they are not identical. I never would argue that anti-Islam, anti-Muslim attitude is qualitatively the same. even if I'm a psychologist. Yeah? The roots are different. And the fourth point is, there's a tricky thing in it. The tricky thing is that one prejudice can cause the discrimination of a completely other group. So anti-Semitism, because it's linked to this ideology, can cause a discrimination of another group. In a situation when you see, oh no, in this situation it's not allowed to discriminate Jewish people. And this prejudice, which is linked to an ideology, can increase the discriminatory intention of other groups.
How do you see anti-Semitism among radical Muslims in Europe?
Maybe we come to it a bit later, when you see, yeah. Or what is your question? Is it the level?
You know, facts and figures show that the increasing wave of anti-Semitism in Europe is due to radical Muslim groups,
yeah,
and radical Muslim communities. So my question is, how do you see the link between the Muslim, radical Muslims and anti-Semitism in Europe?
We are analyzing terror files of jihadists and Islamist young offenders, and 95% share anti-Semitic attitudes. So Israel, the Jewish state, is one of the outgroups. But for some groups, this anti-Semitism is an ideological vehicle to legitimate a certain kind of violence. So we have to speak about the internalized and clear, conscious, shared anti-Semitism within this radical Islamist movements, and anti-Semitism as a vehicle, as a tool to legitimate another thing. But sure, this is one of the biggest problems. This is why I decided to speak about radicalization. But it's different from the, when it comes to radical groups, it's a bit different from the mainstream population. I'm now speaking about the mainstream population because that's why I'm a bit reluctant to answer very quickly to your question. But if you go in the mainstream population, there's a traditionally culturally shared anti-Semitism. When it comes to cultural groups, there's a politicalized anti-Israel sentiment. So it's, for them, it's anti-Semitism is much more a political argument than for the mainstream population. But sure. So, I will show you some, only some, of the results we have. But first of all, last year we asked a representative German population the question you already answered, right? So these are the questions. And now you can compare yourself with the average German population. We asked 2,000 people, which are sampled by representative criteria. We cannot generalize to the total population, but you know. Okay. Before I show you some data of group-focused enmity, I can say to you there is absolutely no prejudice in Germany. We are a completely prejudice-free country. Because, this is unfortunately not in English, the red bar is I agree. So nearly about 72% said, I approach everyone without prejudice. I accept everyone the way he or she is. 80%, more than 80% of our Germans say we are tolerant, and even more say we are open to strangers. So absolutely no xenophobia in Germany. That's great. People are tolerant. So come to Germany, we are very nice people. This is, yeah.
May I ask, do you think there are simply lying in this survey? Or do they really consider themselves tolerant? So for example,
no.
I'm sure
this is what we did here is, maybe you are trained in methods. What this is simply a measure of bias. We all are motivated to make a good impression to others. This is what Irving Goffman, symbolic interactionism, told us. Yeah? In the morning you dress up, you want to make a good impression. So my problem is when we measure these items, a lot of people from methods say this is completely influenced by bias. So there's a bias in the measurement. And my argument was, I measure this bias and I take it for a second as granted. I want to see if people have this bias. They have this bias. This is one of the problems also with when you talk with people who are very anti-Semitic and you're doing qualitative interviews. You have only few people who say, I'm so brave. I'm an anti-Semite in your perspective. Most people say, no, I'm arguing about Israel. I'm arguing about not every Jew. But you know, there are some Jews. So people, even in qualitative interviews, I can show you a lot of studies, they've in their self-perception, they are not prejudiced. This is what it shows, simply. What it simply shows. It's not a bias in measurement, but it's a natural psychological process. This is something people are motivated. Most of the people from this Pegida movement, that's what they exactly argue. They argue, we are the tolerant people. We want to close the borders. We want to let only those in who are benefiting, because this is how our society works. And if you let in people who don't benefit to society, this society may discriminate them. And then, this is why we are honest. We say, no, keep them out. Let them grow up where they come from, etc. But this is a problem with the difference between the perspective I have from on myself and the things we are, how we perceive the world. And you will see this here. This is good news from Germany. We did a huge survey 12 years. We have data from 2002 to 2014 now. So it's 12 years. And it shows that xenophobia, I don't like the term xenophobia. It's the survey group. It's a huge group. They like the term xenophobia. I'm a trained psychologist and I don't have a medicine. I don't have a therapy against trained xenophobia. But anyway, it's anti-immigrant prejudices, racism, Islamophobia, anti-homosexual prejudice, anti-homeless, anti-unemployed, anti-ziganism, asylum seeker. It's going a bit down. It's quite stable because we are measuring here attitudes. This is a restriction of the method. But in the last year, it went down. What we see, for example, in anti-immigrant attitudes, there's a wave. And this is something we see, we already have from research from the United States. The United States, they have monitoring instruments now since 40 years, 40, 50 years. You see a wave. We have an increase in group-focused enmity until the financial and the economic crisis in Germany appeared. We have an increase. Then during the crisis, you have a decrease. And then after the economic crisis, you have a slight increase. Which tells us a lot about the roots of prejudices. Quite constant is anti-Semitism, sexism, and prejudices against the handicapped, disabled people. Quite constant during the last 5 years, 7 years, until 7 years now. It's quite constant, doesn't change. There's also a second psychological effect because this is a measurement of attitudes. You can ask yourself, just think about a group you really don't like. You really don't like. For you, yourself, it's an out-group. You don't have to say it. Maybe professors or Germans. And then ask yourself under what circumstances you would change your attitude. The group you most don't like, you take it to the barrier. So this is quite stable here. But you have a single support for utterances which don't fit to the self-perception of the Germans. For example, there are too many foreigners in Germany, still 37% believe that. There are too many. And it's completely independent on the ratio of foreigners. In Germany, we have the problem that for a very long period, we called people coming from immigrants, foreigners, Ausländer. Muslims should have no right to immigration to Germany, which is against the constitution, 18%. It's against the constitution. You cannot discriminate Muslims like that. The state should be kind to testing applications for asylum. This is a rejection, so it's reverse coded. 65% in the last summer said no. They rejected this item. A woman should concentrate on the role to be woman and mother and not sit in a summer school, 18%. So single, you have single utterances where you have I. What we also found in the survey is something we also have in other European surveys. I just refer to Germany now. But I can show you the same in the Eurobarometer. At the in spring this year, we have Eurobarometer data, not so very differentiated like our data, but the same pattern. What we see is, and this is something astonishing, it came back, the group of young respondents in our survey, and it's controlled for other effects, education, etc., etc., the 16 until 13-year-olds, and the people who are very old or who are beyond 60, they have the highest level of all these different prejudices. And the middle-aged group has a lower level. And it's significant. The difference is significant. So it's the young people and the elderly people. And linked to these changes in the trends across the years, you can say it's groups who are competing for something. The young generation now has to compete. And maybe prejudices is a good tool, a good way to survive in this competition. So it's the 16 until 30 years old respondents who have higher agreement. The same with right-wing extremist opinions. We now have data on clear right-wing extremist opinions. So clear right-wing extremist opinions are you are in favor of dictatorship, national chauvinism, xenophobia, this is anti-Semitism, social Darwinism, and this is the trivialization of the national socialism, not very high. These are very hard items, and you have to agree. So you see, for example, trivialization of national socialism, it's only 3.5% of the group of 16 until 30-year-olds. It's low. But this group clearly agreed to these statements. Yeah, but you see national chauvinism, it's nearly 15% in the young generation, 15% in the elderly generation, it's the young and the elderly. So the young generation, which had so much time to, yeah. And this didn't shift, this increases, and we have other studies as well. One facet of this group-focused enmity syndrome is, and this is an idea of Norbert Elias, a famous British sociologist. He wrote a very nice book. You all should read it. The book is The Established and the Outsider. He's argued that the prototype of the prejudice is the prejudices against anyone who's new. If you all, we all changed our housing, our flats, or we live in houses where someone new came in. You know what's happening? Oh, there's someone new nearby. He's living next door. Who's she? Who's he? And then you take a lot of evidence. You keep the distance. And the newcomers, they have to show up. And this is a facet of group-focused enmity which is increasing. Who is new somewhere should be satisfied with less. Who was living here has more rights than those who came later. It's increased. Last year we had the opportunity to have two surveys in Germany. I mixed them. But in another survey on integration of immigrants, we had statements like, I like it when our traditions are reanimated. 61.4% of the German respondents, 2000, agreed. Reanimation of our traditions. That's what we saw in the Spreelichter in this video. Reanimation. Hey, we are Germans. Do you remember? We were Germans. The same happens in other European countries. The same happens in every other European countries in the right-wing populist. This is a right-wing populist ideology. Now it's our time. We immigrated, we tolerated, we accepted. We invested a lot of money into the reduction of prejudice. Now our traditions, where are we? It's important that we center our identity, values and characteristics more strongly, 60%. It's the majority of the Germans we interviewed. And then we had the opportunity to compare measurements of anti-Semitism in Germany. We had a measurement in 2004 of traditional anti-Semitism, and we had exactly the same measurement in June 2014. That's where we had our main survey. And then what we observed across Europe in certain countries was these demonstrations, a lot of Muslim demonstrations, pro-Palestine demonstrations against the intervention of Israel in Palestine. So we said, okay, this happened in July 2014, we had these demonstrations, we make a repeated measurement in September. What you see is, yeah, compare 10 years, the traditional anti-Semitism goes down from 15% who clearly show this facet down to 9%, but during the hot summer, hot and politically hot summer last year, it went up until September to 14%. Traditional stereotypes, Jews have too much influence, Jews are more loyal to Israel than to Germany, so it's a clear, overt devaluation of Jewish people. It increases after the demonstrations against Israel. Yeah? And the secondary anti-Semitism, we have now 2004, 14 June, 14 September. We can only compare this traditional anti-Semitism, but we can compare 2004 and September. There's a slight increase in secondary anti-Semitism. Secondary anti-Semitism is, yeah, not traditional, but Israel's interventions are perceived to be Jewish. So it's, no, I'm against what the Jewish government in Israel is doing with the Palestine people. Israel-related anti-Semitism. Secondary anti-Semitism, I want to get rid of the history of the Holocaust. We are not responsible. The Jews took more advantage from the history, and we have to stop it now. Secondary, get rid of the history, reverse the guilt. This is secondary, increases, but Israel-related anti-Semitism went down, and anti-Semitism, where people said what Israel is doing, what the Jewish government in Israel is doing can be compared to what the Nazis did to the Jews. This is a comparison of nationalist socialist crimes with Jewish policies went down. So this demonstration increased the traditional stereotypes and not so much the modern stereotypes. Which means there's a change in the political framing of what is in Israel is happening. It's okay if Israel is doing something as an Israel state, but it also brings up the traditional stereotype. This is an argumentation also in favor of the psychological model that stereotypes can be recharged all over. It's an increase in traditional stereotypes. So chilling democracy and elites, people like me, anyway, do not have any influence of what the government is doing. This is a very frustrating attitude. We can do whatever we want, no influence. It's against the idea of democracy, where people have the influence, at least you can go voting. This is something which is really interesting. We analyzed the political preferences of the people, and the non-voters have nearly the same profile as the right-wing populist parties. There, you can compare the political attitudes of non-voters much more with people who vote right-wing populist parties and not the other parties. We published it, but a lot of mainstream parties didn't want to ignore it. Politicians bypass laws when it's for their own sake, and the democratic parties blabber everything and do not solve the problems, which is critical for democracy. Democracy, we expect that the representatives, they are in conflict, they regulate the conflict, they talk a lot, but then things change. Very clear critics in democracy, what you saw on the street, and what we see in the data, this is the critics to democracy, and this is right-wing extremist attitudes. This is controlled for influences of age, education, etc. pp. You can control it, and then you find a linear regression. So it's a complete correlation. As soon as people have the sentiment, stronger and stronger, the sentiment that democracy failed, then right-wing extremism is increasing. And this is people, here, data from people who said they don't vote a right-wing extremist party and they will not vote them next Sunday, if they have the possibility. So we put out of the data the people who argued we are right-wing extremists. Yeah? Because if you are right-wing extremists, then you it makes no sense to analyze. And this is group-focused enmity, so this is an indicator of all different prejudices, increase. It's an increase. Critics on democracy, group-focused enmity. Anti-EU. Life standard of taxpayers is threatened severely by euro crisis. 40% nearly. Considering the euro crisis, I'm very anxious about the savings of German citizens. 42%, 43%. Again, controlled for other things. This is the critics in the euro crisis. This is group-focused enmity. It's linear, it's a correlation. Soon as people start that the euro failed, the euro crisis responsible for my deprivation, etc., group-focused enmity increases and can show it for every facet: anti-Semitism, anti-Muslim attitudes, etc., etc. Law and order, authoritarianism. This is people here during the years, the red line, who clearly have a right-wing populist attitude. So they are in favor of law and order, authoritarianism. Stop immigration, control immigration. If a foreigner, an immigrant, is doing something wrong legally, chase him away. It's anti-Semitism, it's anti-Islam attitudes. Yeah, so it's a mixture of law and order, authoritarianism, and anti-Semitism, anti-Islam attitudes. And this is the sentiment, sometimes I must act violently not to lose. So a very, very general intention to harm another person. And this is the attitudes of the right-wing extremism to violence, and this is people who don't agree, to right-wing populist sentiments. So there's a higher level of aggressive intention and people with a right-wing populist attitude. There's a link. And this is increasing during the last years and not decreasing. It's very stable. If you're not right-wing populist, then your attitude toward violence is quite stable. But if you're right-wing populist, the probability that the acceptance of violence in certain situations increased. And this is critical for the countries. It's not only the anti-Semitism and other facets, but it's a mixture here, which is critical. Anger, hate, and violence, what we may have ignored during the last years is when we spoke about anti-Semitism, when we spoke about right-wing extremism, that we didn't speak too much about the emotional component. What we see in the streets across Europe now, and you go to every European country, is there's emotional protest. There's hate, rage, anger. The rage of citizens toward immigration is absolutely reasonable. These are people who completely agree to this item. 23% in the center of society. It's nearly one quarter. Strange influences on our culture must be limited to a feasible degree. 40%. 40%. Limited. Strange influences of other cultures. In Germany, you cannot say something bad about foreigners and Jews without being blamed to be a racist. 58%. So 58%, 80% believe I'm tolerant. And most of them believe, when it comes to Jews, oh no, I'm tolerant. I'm not saying something, Jewish people have too much influence, you know, but I cannot say it. Because then someone would say, I'm not tolerant, but I'm tolerant. You cannot argue. We did a study on anti-Semitism with students, and we gave them two groups. We manipulated the study. One group of students had a questionnaire, and on the front page, we printed questionnaire on anti-Semitism. And in the other group of students, we did the questionnaire, the same questionnaire, and on the front page, there was only addressed questionnaire. We expected that students, our students, who read, questionnaire on anti-Semitism, try to suppress their anti-Semitic attitudes. No, absolutely no difference. But in both questionnaires, we had one item, and this item asked, do you think that you can say your political opinion public, very public and open, in Germany? And there were about 18% of our students who disagreed, who said, no, I cannot. I cannot say my opinion in the public. And these 18% significantly in every facet of anti-Semitism, traditional, secondary, anti-Israel, compared to the nationals, in comparison to National Socialists, they had significant higher level of anti-Semitism. So it's a suppression. Which is okay, which is okay. I tell my students, it's okay if you suppress prejudices. So, and now back to the items you answered. We did a study on immigration and integration. This is a hot issue all over Europe. What to do with the refugees from the conflicts, refugees from the wars. In Germany, it's a big debate. We have a significant increase in hate crimes against refugees, asylum seekers. This big Pegida movement is not in the media anymore, but they move now to houses of asylum seekers, and we have severe, heavily attacks, burnings, killings, etc. So in our survey last year, and this was last year, it's about 11 months ago, 36% of the Germans said, I will be happy about a stronger welcome culture. And I would assume that here 80%, 90%, made a plus. But in Germany, in the average population, 36. I'm happy that so many migrants decide for my country to be their home, 36. It's not the majority. I like it when migrants who come to my country keep their cultural roots, 60%. So yeah, make your pizza. That's with Germans, yeah? If you come from Italy, make the pizza, and if you make the pizza, it's okay. Turkish,
If you're a Turk and you kill your lamb in your garden in the head of the Bielefeld festival,
Do
you agree?
Yeah, now it's, yeah.
It's not, there's yeah, no
but
difference.
The, we have a heavy control on how you kill it now.
Yeah, but that's what I mean.
A heavy control.
That's what I mean. Is there any difference between
certain
countries? They're more tolerant with the Italian and the pizza than with the Turk and the lamb?
No, I don't know.
Well,
it's a good, it's a nice
lamb,
study.
If you use the lamb for kebab or dinner, then you're fine.
Yeah, and then you're fine, yeah. I would say there's no difference. If you do it for a religious tradition, no. Yeah, it's there was a heavy debate about Beschneidung. What is it? The religious tradition.
Circumcision.
Yeah, that's it. This one, there was a heavy debate. And this was the debate, the first debate where Jewish and Muslim communities were involved. And it was very politicalized in the beginning, and then it calmed down. Maybe because for most of the Christians it's a bit threatening to speak about it. Who's new somewhere, who came later, has to be pleased with less in the beginning, 30%. You see, it's important that we put our identities more into the center, 60%. That's what you already said.
Five,
and this is only people who agreed. Only people who agreed. Not who said, So, when we address these questions, you see, there's a lot of ambivalence. There's a lot of ambivalence when we measure the individual attitudes. When you ask of your perception, your estimation of the reality, and you're not sure. And what we have in the ambivalence is what I learned from all the data is that what causes an ambivalence is because people, when they answer questions about other groups, if I'm not Jewish, about Jewish communities, maybe I show this ambivalence because we have three questions which are linked to that. The first question is, if I'm asked about the cultural roots of others, I ask, who am I? The question, who am I? What about these traditions? Where I'm located? Who are we? So the people in our service give not only a statement about their impressions, but who are the others? Who are they? These three questions are always linked to these questions of integration, of enmity, etc., etc. The problem is that from a social psychological point, we look for asymmetry between our self-identification, and the others who share our group. So normally we think implicitly the question of who am I is similarly answered by those people who are in my group. The problem is that these questions imply who they are, and this is conflictual. This can be conflictual. So reducing this enmity means you have to address all three questions and bring them into some kind of harmony. And this shows the data when we ask the people about how to cope with this new emigration. And this causes polarization, and that's why I started with a picture about polarized groups, radicalization in society. 60% want a stronger welcome culture, but 31 in our service clearly rejected it. So one third is favoring and the other third clearly rejects. And both groups are polarized. 47 have a positive attitude toward diversity as a concept, but 25% clearly reject it. Say no, stop diversity. It's a waste. 55% like it when migrants feel at home in Germany, but only 36% like it when so many migrants decide for Germany as their new home. You can come in. Welcome. But if you're in my flat, now we have to speak about the rules. And don't feel too much at home. So this is a polarization. And it shows this ambivalence between me, the others. So absorbing radical. One model is, or one interesting point is, that when it comes to group-focused enmity, prejudices, stereotypes, etc., can be relevant in this process of radicalization. One model we work with, which is to a certain extent convincing, is a model that when people become radical, it first starts with some kind of a legal protest. So there's a crisis of trust. I don't trust into the societal system. I have a decrease in my trust that democracy is a good thing. Then the probability is high to show up legal protest. And this is how right-wing populist movements sometimes start, with the idea legal protest. But if you then have the experience that this legal protest fails, then a conflict of legitimation appears. Is a legitimation referred to the democratic system? If this conflict of legitimation is not solved, is frustrating, then on the third stage there can be a crisis of legitimacy. Then you're completely dehumanizing the enemy, depersonalization. And then after the third step, this extremist violence, terror, etc. are very probable. This is a model of radicalization, and the interesting point is that we show by data that all these three steps have to be fueled up by propaganda, etc. pp. And this is where anti-Semitism, where all this group-focused enmity comes in. So prejudices, stereotypes, group-focused enmity is constantly a very good tool to heat up the different stages of polarization. If you look into radicalization, where this group-focused enmity plays a very important role, then it can have many, many causes. There are some causes, and Monica told you a lot about the psychological roots of radical prejudices against outgroups. There are some roots on the intrapersonal level, but you can become radical right-wing, populist, extremist on an interpersonal level because you have social networks that make you radical. This is different from a level of intergroup. You can become radical because you define yourself as a member of group fighting against an outgroup. Or there can be reasons and factors on a more structural, societal, ideological level. So radicalization can be triggered, can be pushed forward on very different levels. And it's a very complex process. If you look into data, there's a kind of good, and now I change to a view on people who harm others because they hate others, because their enmity is at least motivating them to attack, to harm others, because the others are in the outgroup. There's a study by Lützinger, and she studied terrorists, extremists, militant radicals, extremist persons. And she studied the intrapersonal, the dispositions of the people. And what you can show by the data, by qualitative analysis of these files is, there are some dispositions. For example, some of them have a very specific relation to the definition of themselves and the others. So you find a disposition that the life event I'm living in is very unforeseeable. I don't have the control about what is happening to me. And this makes you prone to radical ideologies. Because these radical ideologies, because prejudices, give you a more clear answer about who you are and who has the control. People are impulsive, very intrinsic motivated. She finds by these offenders there's a quest for order and structure. These offenders look for clear order and structure. Enmity, radical ideologies, anti-Semitism gives you a structure. It shows you rules. And this is something which works for the radicalization, because it attaches the disposition to look for structure. Adventure and risk appetite. So this is what she saw in people who attack others, who, who, who try to harm them is that from a disposition, this risk appetite is very attractive. Thrill, lowered sensibility, anxiety, that's what Monica talked about, the self-esteem. Experience of discrimination. When we talk about radical people who become very radical in a movement and who attack others and harm others because of their stereotypes and prejudices, we find in the files that a lot of them feel themselves to be discriminated. Now I'm doing a lot of analysis with files of jihadist terrorists. We're looking for the prejudice structure, and when you look for the structure of prejudices, their ideologies, you see they themselves argue that they are discriminated. It doesn't have to be the fact. From an ideological intergroup level, and this is more social psychological level, yeah, in our context are the categories and the salience who lets you in radical movements, who gives you a hint who is the outgroup. People look around for identity consistent behavior, and especially in radicalization, prototypical members in your group are very relevant. We know from research that for anti-Semitism, of course, elites who show up in anti-Semitic sentiment can be very influential as long as they are perceived to be a prototype of my in-group. So if someone from the cultural, from the political elite is arguing, saying an anti-Semitic argument, if he or she is prototypical for our group, then it's more influential. So self-characterization, self-identity, social identity, group processes, etc., etc., these processes are to some extent much more relevant than the dispositions. This radicalization of violence, to violence, which is caused by prejudices, is very probable when radical ideas cause a conflict. And this is what these movement, right-wing populist movements in our country show us. As soon as you can raise a conflict by staging the difference between we and the others, we are the victims and the others are the offenders. By staging, by giving people a space, bringing the conflict, the political conflict, the conflicts on Israel, into the space, into the local spaces, communication by bringing conflicts into the communication, and this is where the internet becomes very relevant. If the conflict, if anti-Semitic statements can be linked to political conflicts and brought into the communicative space, then radicalization is more probable. Fight about truth and tolerance. This is a political campaign we now observe all over Europe. There's a big fight about the truth. Who has the truth? Who has the true information? Who knows about reality? And a fight about history. All over Europe, there's a fight about the history of the countries, etc. pp. And then if you bring people into the conflict, if you take them into the conflict, give them a stage, a place, yeah, in all these rooms, then you should also give them a way to act. Action is very relevant. It's not anti-Semitic in the attitude only, but we give you the voice. You can radicalize people if you argue you are voiceless and we give you the voice. Because we are in the communicative sphere, in the local space, etc. And give them emotion. What you observe all over Europe now is more and more smaller right-wing extremist, right-wing populist parties are clearly arguing that we have to finish all this arguing. We have to free your emotions. Show up your emotions. Rage. There's a new party, it's not a new party, but more or less new in the political tradition. In Bremen, in Germany, It's called Citizens in Rage. In Rage. We would say as intellectuals that the suppression of emotions is a process of civilization. But this de-civilized propaganda is attractive for people, and then a world of experience. And what I'm arguing is that, I have to come to an end, is when we talk about anti-Semitism, anti-Muslim, anti-Islam prejudices, anti-immigrant prejudices, etc., etc. To my opinion, we have more and more to focus these discriminations with respect to processes of radicalization, which are very attractive for a lot of people in the political domain and in the non-political domain, in what we can call paralyzed societies. And you can work for a radicalization or the critical point or the best way you can radicalize people is when you give them a possibility of safe expression, safe staging. You give them space where they can say, yes, I'm tolerant, and that's why I hate Jews. Because I am honest. And all these people around are not honest. So you give them a safe staging where they can express the ambivalence without being blamed for the ambivalence. This is the fight about political correctness. But this is not enough. Self-expression is maybe it's relevant for people. What radicalization also includes is the staging of the other. I can show you a lot of studies how the other, the stranger, the outgroup, is created. But you will speak about this during the workshop. So the other is produced by ourselves, the immigrant, the asylum seeker, the Jew, the Jewish communities, etc. So other staging is an aspect of radicalization. And if self-staging and other staging goes together, becomes symmetrical, then it works for radicalization. The third is, what we have to observe is the production of the arena. Where is the discrimination happening? So the discrimination of Jews is works for radicalization. They don't want me to talk about this. This is a production of the arena. You understand? They are producing an arena. Bring noise into discussions. Noise is very, from a linguistic point of view, the noise in communication is a very critical thing. So you produce the arena. You don't refer to the living conditions and the life of Jewish communities with your anti-Semitism, but you produce the arena where the anti-Semitic discrimination happens. Staging violence and acts, the way how you can act in radical groups, this act, the violence itself, is produced. The discrimination is produced by the radical movement and not produced by society. We have the control. The next point is production of a world of experience. This is very interesting for young people. That's why I showed you the video. This is a video which was downloaded by young people. They liked the video. We are strong. And we can show by this video without too much arguing, no debates about this production. And you have a shift in normalcy. If you can, with your radical group, shift the sentiment, the curtain mentalities, then you can radicalize. And these are very complex processes, but what we observe in radical groups, and that's why we are analyzing now movements who try to kill others, is that the most influential radical groups works on every of these levels, and they have experts for every aspect of this. They have experts for communication, experts for the production of entertainment, experts for the self-staging, experts for the enemy, etc., etc., etc. I stop here because only a couple of minutes for questions, but I'm here tomorrow as well. I'm here anyway. I have to go back on Tuesday, so you can ask questions in between. I want to stop here not without saying you what you saw, the picture, the painting. It was a painting of Deborah Walker. She's in the Nottingham Mental Mapping Program. We worked with people who cannot express their perception of the reality verbally because they have difficulties, the language, they are too shy, etc. So we asked them to paint a picture of the surrounding they are living in. And Deborah Walker is homeless and she's 53 years old. 53 years. And what she painted is a railway route. What you saw above is a police station. I can show, should I show it again? Yeah. Because it's a real nice picture. Is it here? This is someone who suffers from discrimination and who could not, until this mapping program, express the conflicts she's experiencing. Because in her neighborhood, everybody said, no, we have nothing against homeless. No, we are not prejudiced, etc., etc. What you see is a railway station. This is a police station. And this is the place where Deborah is living. This is her place. There are four other places, and she didn't paint faces or sketches of beings because she said, no, it's always changing who's living there, but I'm here always. And this is a pool, a small lake with fishes inside. And this is the world where Deborah is safe. They said, here I'm safe. Here everything is okay. But here, no, it starts not to be safe. And I try never to cross the railway station because behind is the police. The problem is, this is the only entrance to the city for Deborah, which is a huge problem for care, etc., etc. I wanted to show it to you because this is an experience of a person who cannot express what it means to be discriminated. And if you look into the picture, it's not only a question to us that how do we understand Deborah, but we should frame the question in a different way. We should ask ourselves, what did we do to create such a painting by a homeless people? And you see, it's a complete radical way of life, which is not dependent on Deborah, but which is some kind of a production of a whole staging of life conditions for homeless people. Okay, I stop here. Thank you very much.